Welcome to this lecture on metabolic flux analysis, in which we are going to learn how to open the black box. So instead of only looking into the extracellular rates in a bioprocess, we look into the rates inside the cell. Why is it interesting to look into intracellular rates of metabolic networks? First of all, it opens several opportunities to support and design the metabolic engineering strategies. With the network at hand, we will be able to calculate the theoretical yields of a product from a given substrate, showing the optimal route. Also, you will be able to obtain an overview of all possible routes of the cellular network. When you have constructed a strain, metabolic flux analysis will enable you to calculate which routes in the cell are used and how strongly. Now, we've used the expression metabolic flux already sometimes without properly introducing how it is defined. A metabolic flux is a metabolic reaction rate, respectively the rate of a given enzymatic reaction taking place in the cell. As it is in the cell, the metabolic rate is expressed with respect to biomass, thus a biomass-specific flux that can be expressed in the units of millimoles per gram cell dry weight per hour. Thus, the biomass-specific conversion rate from glucose-6-phosphate into fructose-6-phosphate by glucose-6-phosphate isomerase will be the metabolic flux from glucose-6-phosphate to fructose-6-phosphate. This would be one flux in the cellular reaction network. Typically, cellular networks will be represented as reaction network graphs with the metabolites as nodes and the reactions as edges. In this lecture, we will use a very simplified cellular network representing central carbon metabolism in a condensed form. The cell takes up glucose and converts this into glucose-6-phosphate, the first intracellular metabolite in this network. The first steps of glycolysis are lumped into one reaction V2, producing 2-pyruvate from 1-glucose-6-phosphate. Pyruvate is a central branch point in the network. On the one hand, pyruvate can enter the sequence of reactions representing the TCA cycle. Pyruvate can take the reaction V6, representing an anaplerotic reaction to fill the TCA cycle, or it can be converted to ethanol and CO2. Our challenge for today is to produce malate from the substrate glucose using this cellular network. Please note that for simplicity, we have not taken energy coupling or redox cofactors into account, but focus on the carbon network. Looking into this network, there seem to be 2 possible paths to malate. One going the route V1, V2, V6, and then V7. The other taking the cycle V1, V3, V4, until V7. Taking the cycle will actually not work. Running the cycle at a speed of 1 will consume 1 malate and 1 pyruvate at the start and produces 1 malate, thus nothing will be left over to export, leaving as only possibility to take the first route, V1, V2, V6 and V7. Now please realize that this route requires CO2 for the step V6 from the reactions, and from the reactions V1, V2 or V7 we do not obtain CO2. We can see 2 possibilities to produce CO2. The cycle V3, V4, V5 will produce 3 CO2 from 1 pyruvate. Or we take V9, which will produce 1 CO2 per pyruvate. Let's look into the first option and generate the flux map using this setup. 1 glucose enters the network, generating 2 pyruvate. Here we will now split 3:1 between V6 and V3. Leading to the production of 1.5 malate per glucose. In the case of the network using V9 as source for CO2, the branch at pyruvate has to split 1:1 in V9 and V6. With this split, we obtain a production of 1 malate per glucose, so you can see that this route will be less efficient. This network analysis now demonstrates that V6 and V7 would require high levels of expression, V9 should best be knocked out, and V3 should be upregulated. Unfortunately, flux and expression levels do not directly correlate, as the enzyme kinetics also play an important role. Thus, the first strain will probably not produce directly the maximum. Analysis of the first mutant has shown this flux distribution, Instead of reaching the optimum of 1.5 per malate per glucose, only 0.2 are reached. Instead of malate, we obtain a significant amount of CO2 and also ethanol. Thus, the next step should be a further downregulation of V9, as well as the upregulation of V3 and potentially V6. I hope this example has given you an idea how network analysis can guide you through the process of strain optimization. Reflecting on these simplified maps, how would we do this for a genome scale model, including cofactors and energy metabolites? Therefore, it is good to analyze what steps we took in the small network and implement this in an algorithm that can be performed by a computer. If we look into the single metabolites, we can see that the sum of the incoming and outgoing flux at each node is equal. There is no accumulation or depletion of intracellular metabolites. This can be translated into equations of fluxes at each node. For example, for glucose 6-phosphate, we obtain 0 equals V1 minus V2, and for pyruvate, 0 equals V2 multiplied by 2 minus V3 minus V6 minus V9. Furthermore, we have defined that the uptake reaction has a flux of 1 millimole per gram per hour. In this network, we can derive a total of 6 flux radiations for the 6 intracellular metabolites as shown on the slide. We count a total of 9 fluxes, 4 of those connect to the extracellular space, 5 are intracellular. With 6 relations and 9 unknown fluxes, we would need 3 measured rates to calculate the remaining fluxes. We can do this by hand, for example by variable elimination, or rely on computer calculations. The most common approach would be to express the linear equations using matrix notations and linear algebra approaches. Without too much repetition of linear algebra, we will first convert the equations into matrix notations and then apply a standard approach to solve the system. To convert the 6 equations with 9 fluxes into matrix format, we will define 2 vectors, the vector of variables, the so-called flux vector, and the left-hand side, and especially the result of the flux relations, which we know is 0 for each node. Thus, here we define a flux vector containing V1 in position 1, V2 in position 2, until V9 on position 9. The right-hand side defines the order of the equations. Here I choose for glucose 6-phosphate, pyruvate, citrate, malate, until CO2, the last metabolite of the network. In the matrix connecting, the balances is now easily filled. In the line for glucose 6-phosphate, we will need for the inflow 1 times V1, for the outflow 1 times V2. Thus, in position 1,1, we will place a 1 for V1 and a minus 1 in position 1,2 for the outflow V2 consuming glucose 6-phosphate. Similarly, the remaining rows are filled. This matrix is called the stoichiometric matrix and contains the metabolic network in a machine-readable format. Commonly, this matrix is represented by the letter N. With this at hand, we can rewrite all 6 equations using 0 equals n multiplied by v. The rest follows standard linear algebra approaches. Let's assume we have measurements from an experiment and we obtain the rates for V1, V7 and V9. These are now known variables which can be separated from the unknowns. This is performed by rearranging the flux vector into known and unknown. Multiplying the equations, we obtain 0 equals nf multiplied by vf plus nd multiplied by vd. The unknowns can now be placed on the left-hand side. All known fluxes are on the right-hand side. So we can now calculate the unknowns from the knowns. With the measured values 1, 0.2 and 0.3 for V1, V7 and V9 respectively, we obtain the shown values for the unknowns. This approach works for networks of basically any size if sufficient measurements are available. If there are not sufficient measurements, assume, for example, that we could only obtain 2 of the 4 extracellular fluxes, the system cannot be solved, there is information missing. In large-scale networks, this missing information is often solved by adding optimization criteria or using additional constraints, like the assumption that a certain pathway is not active. Clearly, assumptions can lead to a bias in the results. To be more precise, we will have to increase the information content from the experiment, which can be done by using tracing using a 13C labeled substrate. Okay, I hope I could show you that metabolic flux analysis can provide insights into the intracellular flux distribution, so which fluxes are used and how strongly. We also saw that the systems are quite easy to solve because they consist of linear equations and they can be done at very large scale. If you want to dive into metabolic flux analysis, there's a series of articles and tools available. I would like to mention here the CellNet Analyzer, which can be obtained from the Max Planck Institute in Magdeburg, or the COBRA Toolbox, which is provided from the University of California, San Diego. Thank you, and see you in the next unit.